In this tutorial video, we're going to look at the outputs layout of the x-agora designer. As you can see, I'm already in the outputs layout. And this is a layout that you would use when you're actually on site about to set up your projectors and all of your media server hardware, or your player machines, as we sometimes call them. And you want to start connecting basically all of your hardware together. So down here in the bottom, we have virtual representations of all of the media server machines in my x-agora network, as well as virtual representations of all of the displays and their orientations on the projection surface. So if I quickly switch to study layout, I can see that I've set up my projectors in a particular configuration, which is mirrored here in the outputs layout. So each one of these displays represents one of my projectors. So if I click on my displays, I get some of the properties of my display. I can set its name. I can check some properties of the actual projector, such as its resolution, lens model, etc. Whether it's in portrait or landscape. I can assign a test pattern to that projector if I wanted to, or whether it's a display like an LED display or whatever. And then I can also, if I need to, perform some color correction on that particular display. Now, if I click on one of my players down here, then I get a different set of properties. I can also set its name. I can assign it a particular color in the interface. I can, very importantly, determine which IP it is connecting to. So this virtual representation of my hardware, I want to actually point to a physical piece of hardware using an IP address. In this case, I'm just running on a single machine, so it's going to be localhost. So whichever player application I launch via this virtual representation is just going to launch on my localhost machine. But if I were to specify an IP address of a remote machine, I would be launching my player on that machine. Then I can toggle between advanced or automatic mode. Advanced mode gives me extended controls for my player. Automatic mode will automatically detect or try to figure out the ideal settings for that player based on certain hardware configurations, etc. I can also set this particular player to be a master player, which essentially allows me to make a particular machine in my network the control machine. So I would move, by setting this to master player, all of my media files in my media library for my project would be copied onto that particular machine over the network. And then I could use that machine to run the x-agora designer and control my whole network. So if I wanted to create a backup machine, for example, I could assign it to be a master player and thereby copying my whole project to that machine. I can also identify the monitors in my network. So if I click Identify Monitors, it shows me that the current monitor that I'm looking at is monitor 1. As you can see here in the monitor property, the monitor I'm currently looking at is monitor 1. So this output, or this player, is going to be opening up players on monitor 1. If I had extra monitors plugged into my machine, I would be able to assign different players to be assigned to different monitors in my network. I can also assign always on top. So that means that the window of the player will always be on top, even if there are, you know, notifications that pop up or anything like that. The visual will never be interrupted by a pop-up or any other kind of event in my computer. I can also select between borderless, windowed, or full screen for the way my player is displayed. At the moment, it was selected borderless. If I set it to windowed and I press play on my player, it will open up a windowed player. And if likewise, if I were to select full screen, my player would open up in full screen mode. I'm not going to demonstrate that because it will take up the entire window of this tutorial video. But in most cases, you're going to want to open players on your remote machines in full screen mode. So this is output one. If I had something connected to output two here, then I could set its output settings. So whichever display is connected to output two, it could have different settings, such as like a different monitor setting from output one. So let's say I just do that right now. I'm going to connect left two, which is one of my projectors or one of my displays, to output two of my media server machine. And I'm going to assign that to open up on display one, which is my current display. And I'm going to see that I get two players opening up on this current, on my monitor one. And the same can be done for output three and output four, which I'm not going to demonstrate. I can also see the status of the availability of Genlock as a feature on that remote media server machine. I can also set rendering settings for that machine, such as VSync or its refresh rate. These are exclusive, however, so if I have VSync enabled, I can't control its refresh rate manually, but I could, if I wanted to, control it manually by leaving VSync unenabled. I can also select anti-aliasing settings. If I want a high level of anti-aliasing, I can do that. And I can also select which GPU or which video card to use on a particular, on my remote media server. So if I have multiple video cards, I can choose which one I want to use for output. I also have the ability to map my physical video inputs to my video outputs. So if I had a live input device connected to my video card or input card, I can determine which virtual input is assigned to a physical input hardware. So these virtual inputs that are assigned to physical hardware are then used in the programming layout when I assign when I put a live input element on my timeline. I can assign that live input to a virtual input, and this virtual input is going to be connected to a physical input here in the outputs layout. So I'm just going to go back to where I was. And finally, the two last things here in the properties are the audio devices. So if I'm connecting to or synchronizing to a SMPTE device or a SMPTE device, I can do that here. And I can also control or update all of the media on this particular machine through its properties menu here in sync. So if I press synchronize scene, I can update the 3D model and as well as some media assets on this remote machine. So what will happen is the 3D model will be dispatched from my server machine, or will be dispatched from my controller machine out to this remote machine. And so these properties will be the same for my other player machines. Another useful feature to mention is this align to viewpoint. So now you can see that I've moved some of my displays just to make it easier for to edit. If I snap those back, they'll conform to the layout in that I defined in the study layout. So another useful thing to see is here in the plus menu of the player section, I can add players, and there are two, depending on which hardware I'm using, I have two options. Either I can use a media server that has four outputs, or one that has two outputs. I can also synchronize all my players here directly, rather than having to click on my player and then press synchronize. I can just synchronize all players at once using this button. I can also open up all the logs for my different players. That's it.